What's your name?
Mia.
Do you know how to lift that thing up?
Yeah.
Whoa. Get your knee under it. Very good. All right, off you go.
Whoa, whoa, Nina, whoa, slow down, whoa, whoa.
This is a story about two wheels and an engine. About the many all over the world whose passion is the motorcycle.
I don't want pickles. Just want to ride on the motorcycle.
This is a story that spans generations, crosses borders, and defies stereotypes. It's adventure and family, adversity, community, and competition. It's a story about undying devotion. It's about nothing and everything all at once.
Late last week I was on my bike, running to a friend named Mike.
It's a story about machines and the people who live to ride them. And it's about that simple thrill of turning that throttle. I'm Dana Brown, and these are the stories that happen on any Sunday.
Sunday's ride day. It means I get to go ride, and then free from all the other crap from Monday to Saturday. Don't even have to think about it.
There's some connection you make when you're small about the fascination of motorcycles. I don't know quite what that is, but nevertheless, it's very deeply seated within you.
I know at 8 years old, I was building quite pretty big, like dodgy built, you know, plank of wood with a heap of bricks underneath it, but I was building like big jumps that were, you know, I'd come flying down a hill and jump. Three of my friends laying on the ground with their bikes and land on a sketchy little landing with bricks in it.
Exploring the limits has been part of motorcycling since the beginning. The Daredevil has been around since motorcycles first hit the road in the late 1800s. Sideshow performers who took ridiculous risks to wow the crowd and make a buck. Back in the day, it was less a matter of skill than just kind of being nuts. There was one man all other daredevils were measured by, Evel Knievel, a cultural icon whose feats would inspire a whole new generation of riders and ultimately the 21st century sport of freestyle motocross. Of this new crew of daredevils, one man stands above the rest, Robbie Madison, a daredevil since birth.
As a kid, I was a big dreamer, you know. I was out there building jumps in my front yard at, as young as I can remember. I think I was 2.5 or 3, like my son's age now, and we had this little step. I just tried to ride straight off it, and I, sure enough, went straight head first, smashed my and fractured my skull. We lived at the top of a hill called Hospital Road. It was probably lucky for my sake that there was one so close to us, you know, because we were down there frequently and I'd walk in and I'd say, hi Robbie, hi Debbie, hi Peter. Oh, they knew the whole family and we joke about that now, but it was like, there was something in me at a young age before I was old enough to make decisions. So when I became old enough to make decisions, I'd make crazy ones.
Put your hands together, I see Robbie's kind of already made his mark in freestyle. He's been a top three guy for however long. I met Robbie in 2005 when he first came out to an event I was doing called Ride to the Hills, this natural terrain freeride event. And, you know, if there was a jump that they didn't want to hit or something, he'd be the guinea pig. He's that guy that's willing to go first and take a chance.
Done for the day. Anyone have any complaints with that?
No,
bro. A lot of guys are really focused on contests and doing kind of something that's as cool as the last guy did. And Robbie's always like, all right, what can we do that's just way different?
Every time you come up here, it's not like you get used to it. It's crazy, you can't even see the takeoff, huh? And then at the takeoff, you can't see the landing.
That's what they're saying, yeah, you stand up.
Totally blind.
What was your first impression of Robbie?
It's crazy. That was it, you know, it's crazy. He told me he was gonna jump a football field, and I was like, all right, yeah. Then he came and asked me if I'd build him a big ramp, and that was it.
I think he's hands down the modern day 21st century Evel Knievel.
We're not adrenaline junkies, you know, and I think people looked at Evel Knievel and all these daredevils along the way. It's either they got no fear for life, they're probably drug addicts and all this kind of stuff. I'm trying to do all my jumps for authentic reasons. If you look from the outside, it looks like I'm out here trying to prove points, but really these are dreams that I have and I come up with them, majority of them myself, or I get inspired.
He pitches to us all the time. You just sit there and you're kind of like overwhelmed. And then a year later, it comes true.
Can't wait to see what the stunt double thinks when he looks at this jump.
It's a huge process. Like every jump, people just think it just happens, but usually it's a couple years in the making. I'm like, oh great, here we go again. I'm gonna have no fingernails again.
Amy and Robbie fell in love in Australia, and together they set out to realize the dream in the United States.
We come over here with two suitcases, like no motorbikes, no nothing.
We first came, we lived on a property just a few hundred metres from where we're at right now, and we're living in a little shed.
Then living on people's floors.
We had our car burnt down.
Bouncing to friends' houses, like just never felt comfortable.
To be here at this place, I mean, we pinch ourselves every day, we're very fortunate. But I'm just here following my heart and my passion, and when I was a little kid, I think if you watch my son for 10 minutes, you can see it's in him too.
All he wants to do is jump everything. I always say he looks like me, but he acts like Robbie.
You know, he just naturally wants the thrill. There's that need, and it's probably in our blood, it's in our gene.
Go, 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 go!
Hopefully he doesn't follow in his career footsteps. It's very stressful. I don't think I could handle two of them.
A lot of times I'm doing these jumps and she's carrying kids, you know, so I think that gets pushed into the kids too, so I got these crazy kids coming through. But I probably deserve it, you know, because of what I put my poor parents through.
Well done.
Robbie doesn't exactly fit the daredevil stereotype. He's very meticulous, working diligently with his team for months to prepare for a stunt.
One more set.
I asked for it.
How's that feel?
Feels great. Yeah, it's lightweight.
All right, should we try the other one?
Sure.
There's too much going on for me to be on point and checking everything, you know, so I need people in my corner that I can trust to double check all the stuff along the way.
We talked about it and talked about angles and pitches and all the rest of that stuff, and he goes, you think it would work? I was like, heck yeah, it'll work. Let's do it.
When did you first hear about this from
him? Like 2-3 weeks ago. Yeah. I'm a gossip queen, so he didn't tell me much right away, which is probably smart.
It's huge. Somebody's life, you know, and they're trusting me to go off the jump that I made, so.
The plan was simple. Come to Park City, Utah, and jump his bike off the 120-meter Olympic ski jump. he would soar the distance of a football field while dropping more than 200 feet.
He told me he's going to ride down the mountain like Daddy. And I'm like, yeah, maybe not this week.
Yeah, I'm like, give it a year or two.
Let Mommy get over this one.
I feel pretty nervous, but I think I'm more nervous because I am pregnant. I've got all these extra emotions, and I think that's why I've been safety Sam, like pointing out all the dangers, all the extra things that could go wrong to Rob.
I feel like I've kind of checked off the list and everything's in order and we're set to go. As long as Mother Nature is the only one I can't control, but I looked at the weather and it's saying between 6 to 10 miles per hour, so it's not ideal, but I said, all right, let's get up there at the crack of dawn and then we have the whole day to decide when we're going to jump, you know?
A little after 8 a.m., with the wind picking up, Robbie headed to the top. Robbie had flown over 375 feet while dropping the height of an 18 and a half story building.
Dude, that one was gnarly. Done, though. Good job, dude. That was sick.
That was great. I'm so glad you're okay. I'm so glad. Oh, good job, babe.
Thank you, guys.
But more than the record, it was the satisfaction of turning a dream into a reality. While the Daredevil has greatly evolved in the century and a half since the motorcycle was introduced, there are other forms of riding that haven't. One of the oldest and most revered forms of racing is the AMA Pro Grand National Championship, a series of 19 events that takes place at fairgrounds and dirt tracks across the United States. And in the world of flat track, no event holds more prestige than the Springfield Mile. While the Pro Grand National Championship is over 60 years old, it still attracts a new crop of talented young riders.
Started racing with the guys more and more, and you know, they all treat me like family. You know, our sport's really, really close.
I think the bond is a little closer with what we do. Be able to know and trust the guy you're racing with, trust them at 130 miles an hour going into turn one.
We've got such great young talent coming up nowadays. These young kids, I'll tell you, are just full of it. I mean, they are full of fire.
Something about it, even though, you know, it's not as big as some of the other disciplines, it's still kind of like, you know, this is the roots, this is where it starts.
4 decades ago, this was the pinnacle of American motorcycle racing. The legacy of these racers still echoes at Springfield, like former champ Mert Lawwell, who after his racing career became a mechanical designer, making big advancements in prosthetic arms. Something that ended up changing the life of amateur racer Jake McCullough.
He saw the mechanical hand that I made. He and his dad got together and said, he's got to have one of those. So they got one, and it completely brought him out of being in the background. And now he's a motivational speaker. He's very involved in doing anything he can to get amputees back on motorcycles.
Jake came to Grand National Weekend to race in the amateur event. And for the first time ever, he made the finals.
Every time I get off a dirt track, when I really went out hard and really had it sideways, it's just, there's no better high in the world. To truly enjoy this, it does take a special type of crazy, but normal's overrated. You can't live in a box forever. You have to be able to step out and have fun.
Sunday is for the professionals. No event holds more prestige than the Springfield Mile.
It's one of the longest running dirt tracks in America. There's all sorts of legends that have won this race and raced here.
It's produced so much drama, so much great racing. It is really like the Kentucky Derby of flat track races.
Flat track racing is so difficult because it's so simple at the same time. First place to last place will be within a second.
They race handlebar to handlebar, sliding through corners at over 100 miles an hour, then tucked in down the straightaway at 130.
That I hate to say quit evolving, but I think that's also the beauty of it.
Flat track and the AMA Pro Grand National Championship is still ground zero for motorcycle racing, helping to shape modern motocross competition as well as producing new talent, including four MotoGP world champions.
To be able to have that feeling of whether you have traction, you don't have traction, that's where a dirt track comes into a good effect for road racers.
All the GP guys starting a flat track and start training, and you know, if you look back, that's where all of them came from.
I was really kind of glad to go because it's one thing, and I tell this to some of the motocross guys, it's one thing to say you're, you know, American champion. It's another thing to say you're a world champion. It's a whole new meaning.
This is MotoGP, Circuit of Americas, the newest stop on the MotoGP Tour. Hey! MotoGP is the top tier of motorcycle racing, a $100 million tour. It takes place in 11 countries across four continents with millions of fans worldwide. It's a traveling carnival comprised of 48 racers, hundreds of mechanics, technicians, and media following along the way. It's been the most prestigious form of racing for decades. These are multi-million dollar machines ridden by incredibly skilled athletes.
Well, I mean, the equipment's definitely changed. I don't think the people have changed. The only difference is you still go as fast as you can go, but now when you get off, there's much further to walk back to get your bike.
MotoGP is a very dangerous sport. Great risk comes great reward. MotoGP racers are international sports heroes, like defending champion Jorge Lorenzo and seven-time champion Valentino Rossi, who's a full-fledged rock star and the biggest sports star in Italy. To become a Rossi, they start young.
I started when I was 4 years old. Yeah. Quite small.
I was all the time crying, but when I was on the bike,
I stopped crying. That's the only moment I give peace to my parents at that time.
Two of the favorites to win the championship are Marc Márquez and Dani Pedrosa. Honda Repsol teammates, both from Spain, but very different in demeanor. Márquez, the fearless rookie, who this year in his very first GP race came in third.
So next step is get the first win, but this is step by step.
Pedrosa, the quiet and calculated veteran, seemingly always on the podium. Dani has finished runner-up for the MotoGP Championship three times.
I think Danny's a super intelligent rider. If the bike is not perfect for him or not set up right, or he doesn't like a certain thing on the racetrack, he won't push it past that. And whereas, say, like a Márquez would.
3 years ago, yes, I was pushing many stupid crashes, but you know, if you need to learn to go faster, it's more difficult.
To do what he's doing is a real fine point between making a mistake that could hurt you and winning the race, if you can get to the race.
During qualifying, Márquez pushed just a little too hard.
First crash of the season for Márquez.
He looks like he's okay, Marc Márquez, but he looks like he had a fair old bang.
With only 15 minutes remaining in qualifying, Márquez was brought back to his garage, where his backup bike was prepared, and the doctors cleared him to ride again. Only 10 minutes after his crash, he was back on the track and going faster than ever. Miraculously, Márquez laid down the fastest lap in the track's history, becoming the youngest person ever to sit on the pole of a MotoGP event.
Marc Márquez has already rewritten the history books yesterday. Can he write another chapter this afternoon? Alongside him is his teammate Dani Pedrosa and the world champion Jorge Lorenzo.
Nearing 2 p.m. race day, the riders lined up on the grid for 21 laps.
Welcome to the second round of the MotoGP World Championship.
Oh, not a great start from Jorge Lorenzo on the inside there. He was very keen to pull the bike across, and he's going to lose position.
No way through at the moment for the youngster. Well over 210 miles an hour for Rosalie.
For the first 10 laps, it seemed to be Dani Pedrosa's day.
Some races you are there and you just feel everything in slow motion. Super slow. And when you have this feeling, nothing can stop you.
Pedrosa had pulled away from the pack with one exception. His young teammate, Marc Márquez.
Julián Márquez probably doesn't have any nails left.
On lap 13, Márquez went for it.
Here he comes.
Dani Pedrosa, after finishing fourth in Qatar, is desperate to beat him. For the last time for turn 12.
No mistakes now.
Surely now we are talking about the new Valentino Rossi.
He's special in his own right, this one.
Marc Márquez, the youngest ever winner of a Premier Class Grand Prix motorcycle race, wins in Texas.
Marc's father watching with pride as his son realized a childhood dream, being congratulated by his idol, Valentino Rossi.
In my room, I have all his bikes of his history, and now I compete with him, and he come to me and he congrats me, so it's special.
Finishing second for Danny, it was a good day, but not a victory.
When you are close like today and you cannot manage, you can taste it. When you don't have a good Sunday, it's the longest afternoon ever.
The next step is try to get that experience for be ready for fight for the championship next year.
At the end of the day, an army of workers pack up tons of equipment and ship it halfway around the world for the next stop on the MotoGP Tour. In the world of motorcycles, not everything is about competition. Sometimes it's just about a Sunday ride. Testing yourself against the terrain. Some Sunday riders are better than most. And one of the best is Carlin Dunn. Carlin works with his dad, Trevor, at their Ducati dealership in Santa Barbara, California, which Trevor has owned for 35 years. A former road racer from South Africa, he was a single dad, raising his son and daughter the best way he knew.
We lived above the motorcycle shop when I was a little kid. I wasn't going to be like an interpretive dancer or anything. It was a motorcycle rider from the get-go.
It had training wheels, and all he knew was on. So as soon as he got dangerous, I'd kill the ignition. He would just freak out. He would stomp his feet and go, no, no, no.
He wasn't like a lot of racer dads where he's taking me to the track and let's practice. It's just what we did.
He was coming up. I was going out. That we were both competitive with each other. That was the best time of my life.
Don't scratch through my stuff, Colin. I'll just put it in there.
I'm not going to make it fall down, I promise. And it's funny, we're like oil and water usually. But when it comes to a motorcycle race, whatever gripe we have against each other, it's just gone. I'm so lucky we got that.
For a father and son outing, Carlin and Trevor decided to load up their bikes and take a trip from Southern California to Utah.
I don't know the last time we went road tripping with each other. It was kind of like old friends.
You sure you got everything?
Yep.
You locked the front door?
Yeah, I locked the front door.
Sure?
Yep.
He's starting to think that he knows more than I do. I think he's got another 35 years to go.
After 12 hours of driving, the Dunns arrive at the Bonneville Salt Flats.
I think this is probably the first step of one of the coolest things you ever do in your life. And to make knowledge of that, I'd like you to go ahead and high-five the person next to you. Here, we make high-five. Yeah.
You get out there, and it's like being in a snowy parking lot. It's like snow. It's like the consistency of snow. It feels like snow, looks like snow, but it's blazing hot.
They came for the 65th annual Bonneville Speed Week, where over 100 racers attempt land speed records on everything from mopeds to rocket cars. It's a happening that gathers riders from all over the world.
Bonneville number 6 for us, and we took it on the plane in suitcases, reassembled it here, and broke 4 records.
I think all these old pieces tell a story. It's not shiny and off the showroom floor.
I mean, the passion that goes into building these things in this garage, that was the fastest thing that's ever gonna be. And it comes out here and reality just slaps you right in the face. It happened to us.
There's no practice runs at Bonneville. You get in line, wait your turn, and at the starting line, off you go with a little help from your friends. Trevor Trevor's turn came, and he got his first taste of flying across the Salt. At the end of your run, you're picked up by your pit crew slash personal nutritionist slash life coach, and then you drive back to the starting line where the roles switch. Carlin's bike was a loaner from speed champion Scott Warner. This is one of the fastest two-wheel vehicles on the planet. It's actually more like a fighter jet than a motorbike, with just as many nuances.
This display only goes to 218. It can't keep up with itself after that. If you look down and it's 218, you know you're cutting a fat one. You got six speeds. If any of the red ones, come on, just leave the switch on.
This is the most important one.
And then we'll turn on this switch here.
Here's one that's going to confuse things.
Turn on our water pump.
Go ahead and shut this one off.
Know where all your parts
are.
Don't
put water on it.
Where the bolts are.
It happens.
So Carlin, with his head swimming, on a bike he'd never ridden, at an event he'd never raced in, set out across the Salt. 100 miles an hour, 150, 180 miles an hour.
That thing is fast. I think I was only in my third gear.
While Carlin was riding a rocket across the desert, his dad wasn't. Trevor would spend more time working on that bike than riding it.
Nothing like smelling 110 octane hot van through a dog food.
In the end, dizzy from the fumes and the heat, Trevor decided just to watch as his son made an assault on the Bonneville Speedway. Just 7 miles an hour below the record, the engine blew. And now for the really tough part, returning the broken fighter jet to its owner. Turns out the owners weren't bummed at all. In fact, they made Carlin promise he'd come back to Bonneville and try it again. And that's what racing is all about. Testing you and your bike against the elements. Today, you'll find people racing motorcycles in some of the most unusual places, in a landscape that looks a lot like Bonneville, but is more than 100 degrees colder. A group of dedicated riders in Alberta, Canada, spend their Sundays braving sub-zero temperatures to build a track on the ice. Siggy Pichot, one of the founders of the Second Gear Club, helps put it all together.
When I was young, I always wanted to race. MotoGP was my dream. These guys were my heroes. Kids get inspired by something like this. The kids learn from a very young age what racing is all about.
All right, you gonna have fun today? Yeah. All right, thank you.
Young and old and everyone in between, people from all over the province flock to this frozen lake, and it's not for hockey. The key to ice racing is to put metal studs on your tires for traction. In fact, in Alberta, they put metal studs on just about everything.
You got your studded ice boots on?
See, look at that, eh?
Oh, you do?
Oh, yeah, I got some more in the trunk if I lose a couple.
So mind your ride, pay attention, don't kill anybody. But don't make a bleed on the track, okay?
When the flag waves, things heat up quick.
Swing it in the saddle just before the break of morn. Take me back to old Alberta, the place where I was born.
There are no trophies, no prize money, just sub-zero fun. It's a little frightening when you crash because it's like 50 buzzsaws coming right at you.
And that Can-Am, I rode one of those Can-Ams once.
like the new age bike, I tell you that much.
I didn't know I could do it either until I tried it. I hear the bacon frying, sizzling in the pan. Coffee is a-steaming in a big 10-gallon can. Breakfast is already good enough for any man. Take me back to old Alberta.
When you get all these people together, by the end of the day, everybody goes home happy and they have a good time. And just the feeling of accomplishment, just putting something like this together.
Motorcycling is a community that brings together the unlikeliest of people.
I remember just being fascinated with it was all the boys, you know, going around in these circles and sliding into turns and going off jumps, and I had to do it. That family, the camaraderie, there's a banter that they have that you won't find in an office setting.
I don't like the Huckabucks, but I like the hippie cheeks.
This common interest is the same as the circus.
Welcome to a two-wheel, three-ring circus, the Orange County Speedway. For over four decades, this show has been entertaining Southern California crowds, led by its ringmaster, Brad Oxley.
If you look at MotoGP bikes or motocross bikes, man, they've really come a long way. But not so for Speedway motorcycles. Really hasn't changed since the first Speedway championships in the late 20s.
Speedway were the cowboys. I mean, the racing is as edgy and sketchy as any supercross road race in the rain or anything else.
Really the purest form of motorcycle racing. Four laps, round and oval, on a motorcycle with no transmission, no suspension, and no brakes.
Speedway racing in general is amazing. The crowd energy, and it's all packed into like this really small like horse arena.
Races are run back to back, with a new one starting every 3 to 4 minutes. A night at Speedway isn't just about the bikes. There's also the sidecars. Brad makes sure that part of the evening is always open to anyone and everyone who wants to come out and race their bikes.
Racing isn't about how fast the guys are going, it's about how close the racing is. And nothing's closer and more unpredictable than the Harley Deuce.
It's all about racing, baby. Speedway, you're racing. A lot of respect for these guys that really do it. We're just a bunch of fools.
Someone's always going to end up upside down, burn a hole in your leg, or whatever it is. It's madness. It's absolute madness out there.
It's just like it always was, and I think part of our success is that we haven't changed the blueprint of Costa Mesa Speedway. We've kept the wheel greased, and we tighten those spokes up and make sure it runs true, but we haven't reinvented the wheel.
I mean, he's really a true motorcycle family and someone who I think really helped keep motorcycling alive here in Southern California.
Roland Sands is more than just a Speedway fan. He's also a former motorcycle champion and now one of the finest custom bike designers in the world.
As my racing career was winding down, I got second in the race and I also finished a motorcycle that I built, this little red Harley Davidson, like custom frame Cosman. That's really nice. And people, I think, paid more attention to the bike than they did the fact that I got second in the race. And I kind of light popped out. I'm like, maybe I could do something different and kind of still be a person getting recognized for doing something that they love. For me, when I look at a motorcycle, I'm like, what could I do with this machine?
Roland and his crew are true artists, and they build their bikes for a very wide variety of clients.
3 years we know each other, yeah. Three, four. Well, I lose track. You got a middle name, Roland?
Wayne.
Roland Wayne's. But Roland Wayne's Sands, yeah. Sounds like a country western singer with an overbite, yeah. This is the low-key bike we put together. Everything was well thought out. We fooled around with a lot of different ideas. And
I like the fact that Mickey had strong opinions. The things that I think made the bike pop, you know, that really came from Mickey and his expression about what he wanted to do.
Yeah, because you ain't going to see two of these.
No.
You know?
When they're looking at buying custom bikes or they're looking at buying custom parts to make their bike their own, they have this picture in their head of what they want. It's really an aesthetic thing. You're stylizing yourself.
The coolest thing is to be able to compliment somebody, how they made that bike personally theirs.
You're looking at something that is more a piece of art, and you wouldn't think somebody could ride it, you know, just the way they're designed.
It's not about comfortable. I want to make sure that I feel right on the bike, and I want to make sure, you know, I don't ride suicide clutch because it's easier, you know. I like to pull up and do that, you know.
If you have a bad back and you have to look behind you to see what's coming, go ahead and look behind you.
We just continue.
Yeah. It's
that's MotoGP style.
Yeah, right?
MotoGP style.
We have a real relationship because we have something in common that we're passionate about. I mean, Roland and I have motorcycles in common, but probably that's about it. He's a pretty straight-laced dude. Roland Wayne Sands.
For Roland, motorbikes are rideable works of art. Elsewhere, they're simply a tool and an absolute necessity.
Rất sở thích của người Việt Nam, bởi vì phương tiện cá nhân đi tới đi lui sử dụng nhiều. Hai xe máy nó cũng giống như một cái đồ chân tách hành vậy đó.
In Vietnam, riding a bike is much more than a passion or a lifestyle. It is life.
Thì chở là nó phải cồng kềnh rồi, thì nó cũng khó chạy hơn chút xíu thôi. Thì mình chạy xe bình thường thì đâu có gì, nhưng mà chắc lên thì nó khó chạy xíu thôi, nó lắc lắc cái đầu xíu thôi. Ăn thua là mình chạy quen là được rồi.
What they get used to is unbelievable. They carry every conceivable kind of cargo on their bikes. And on occasion, you will witness a tragedy. The longer you watch the chaos and the traffic, you'll start to see a kind of organized harmony. And the amazing part is, they do this every day.
That's us. We love that. So it doesn't matter if you're, you know, the average Joe or the big time dude, your love is in that bike.
And that love affair with the motorcycle can lead to some pretty extreme behavior.
Racers are crazy, I mean, just period, point blank.
And there's a drive behind some of these guys that overrides their sense of self-preservation.
If there's one place on the planet where there's no sense of self-preservation, it's Erzberg, Austria, at a working iron mine. The site of one of the world's most grueling events, the Hair Scramble Hard Enduro. 500 competitors representing 40 nations. It's a four-hour race, and most guys are lucky to make it more than 500 yards past the starting line.
You have to be very fit and very young, then you have a chance to finish it. But I'm old and fat. You have to be crazy to do this.
A 21-mile course of pure hell. The Hair Scramble, you'll hear the phrase, "Are you kidding me?" in at least 8 languages. Out of the 500 riders who start the race, only 30 will actually finish.
Really hard, really hard. But doable.
It's a race synonymous with F-words. Fatigue, falling, frustration, and the big one, failure.
When it's over, you don't think about it, and you're looking forward for next year. That's a magic.
And for those who do finish, it's less the thrill of victory than the simple relief of having survived. For some riders, the toughest obstacles aren't found on the track.
We're back. Ladies and gentlemen, my next guest is a two-time X Game gold medalist for women's motocross, and she's the first deaf person to ever compete professionally in the sport. Please welcome, along with her father, Jim, 21-year-old Ashley Fialik. I would think there might be disadvantages to not being able to hear if you're riding a motorcycle professionally.
It's a little disadvantage. You know, I can't hear them, obviously, so I have to hold my line. I can't move around on the track, else I'll hit them. It's an advantage off the track because I can't hear them talking trash about me or anything like that. So it works out good.
We're very happy about that.
There's not a better, you know, sport in the world than riding a motorcycle as a family thing, because I think, you know, like this, you can go camp, you can ride and have fun, and you don't have to race. About 2 years old, Ashley would ride on the front of my motorcycle. So my wife would ride on a four-wheeler. Yeah, I always remember just sitting with my dad on the front and going through the woods, and we'd just go for literally like hours. Yeah, this is the first time we get to ride together in a long time, but maybe even since I'm 50, so. She said, but now it's not really that much fun because she beats me so easy that it's not even. Really? Thinking, you know, it's motorcycles. This is what we did as a family, so we're close. We still do it. She sees a lot of kids like that in motorcycling. You know, the family comes not from racing. I think it comes more from just, you know, traveling together, being together, and doing things, working together.
On Sunday, throw a bike in the back of a truck. And it doesn't matter if it's a dirt road, if it's a sand trail, if it's a cliff, if it's a highway, whatever it is, I can make it my own experience. And that's something that, I'm sorry, nothing else has.
You're getting this incredible rush of wind and speed. It's just like a symphony of events that creates a sum that's greater than the parts.
In the world of motorcycling, there's one form of riding that attracts more competitors, fans, and everyday riders than all the rest. Men and women, sons and daughters, families and friends, you'll find them all across America on a motocross track.
motocross and supercross later on really fits a lot of the American interest, I think. Americans like things that are a little bit wild and rough, and I think this sport fits well.
Motocross is a good thing to be a part of as a kid. Like, it's dangerous and you get hurt, but like, I think it's worth it for what you get out of it.
Motorcycling, it's our common bond, and it's our little excitement together, and that's why I'm giving this to the kids too, because I get to do it with them now too.
You watch them go around, you get more excited really than doing it yourself, you know. Some of those little kids out there, their helmet looks as big as they are, you know.
It's a disease, and once you have it, that's it. It doesn't leave your body, ever.
For those who are very serious about their hobby of motocross, they gather just outside of Sacramento at Hangtown, California, where the AMA Outdoor Motocross Series hosts an event. The first 2 days at Hangtown are reserved for the amateurs. Young and old, they come from all over the country to test themselves against each other.
And you just wonder, like, which one of these kids is, like, going to be the next national champion? They could be here, you know, you just don't know it.
The final day is for the pros, which includes the pro women's motocross.
There's not one thing that I enjoy more than racing dirt bikes, because it's what I love to do, whether it be my job or whether it be a hobby. I mean, I love it.
Courtney Duncan, in her very first pro event, would bring home the win.
One day I'd like to race in the men's and the AMA and just start off in the women's, and it's my first year. It's my first year on big bikes as well, so I'm excited.
For everyone, the biggest race of the day is the 450 men's class, with two-wheeled heroes like Ryan Villopoto, Ryan Dungy, and James Stewart.
When I brought James home from the hospital, I put him on my motorcycle before I ever took him into the house at 2 days old and took him for a ride. My wife thought I was crazy, but...
If I win a race tomorrow, it's always we. And I think the only reason I say that is just because I've always considered my family a part of me. I just see my mom and dad just sitting on a podium right next to me every time I win.
You know, at 13 or 12, he was supporting his family, right? Every race was a dollar.
Back then, we didn't have no motorhome. I mean, motorhome didn't come till we started getting success.
If you grew up having to win to go to the next race, it's hard mentality to try to change, you know, when you're pro. It's just hard for me to go to the gate not expecting a win.
The Hangtown Motocross consists of two motos, 35 minutes apiece. This is one of the most demanding sports known to man. Every time James takes his spot at the start, some of the world's best athletes line up against him. The race into the first turn for the hole shot is like nothing else. Half threading the needle, half running of the bulls. James would get the hole shot in both motos.
Probably the most talented guy ever to throw a leg over a motorcycle. And when James Stewart is on, I wish I could be in James's body to feel what he feels and the speed that he carries.
Sits down during a motocross race, and everyone brings their race face. battle nonstop for 70 minutes. The only time they have to pull a tear off is 30 feet in the air. James battled hard, but ended up finishing third because it was Ryan Villopoto's day. It's a full throttle day, loud engines, fierce competition, but beneath it all, there's a real sense of community.
At the racetrack especially, it's a really family environment, but even the freestyle guys, I mean, most of them have families and kids and stuff, and you kind of wouldn't think it if you didn't know them, like just watching the crazy stuff they do, you know?
See, everyone thinks action sports are like, oh, hooligans or motorcycles and this kind of stuff, but it's what I did as a family. I mean, it's what my dad loved to do. It's what all my uncles loved to do. It's what my mom was passionate about. And, you know, if we went on a camping trip, we brought the dirt bikes.
Hi, guys. Thanks for coming to Nitro. Appreciate it, guys.
Travis Pastrana has become one of the biggest names in dirt bikes, competing in a wide variety of disciplines from motocross to freestyle. And now, combining those passions for his Nitro Circus show.
This Nitro Circus really grasped all these people that still wish they were the 80s stuntmen, that wish they could try stuff that's never been tried.
Nitro Circus is 2 hours of amazement. You'll see all sorts of things flying through the air, including Travis's wife, Lindsay.
You know, our creativity is, hey, we're not gonna be a golfer, we're gonna be the ball. And when we hit, we're gonna launch, and we gotta get in that hole, or it's bad, man.
Travis's affinity for danger, the spills and thrills, has paid off well for him. Travis helped pioneer freestyle motocross. He's also a four-time rally car champion, and even raced a couple seasons in NASCAR. But Travis is more than just a racer. He's also a dedicated family man, albeit it's a fairly unconventional family.
Like the family outing.
Travis's wife, Lindsay, is a pro skateboarder who, like Travis, is a gold medalist in the X Games.
I think skateboards are more dangerous, personally.
If you're riding them.
Hey.
Travis and Lindsay aren't home very often, but when they are, close friends are always stopping by. In this case, AMA Hall of Famer Doug Henry and his daughter. Doug is a three-time motocross champion. He broke his back twice, the last time paralyzing him from the waist down.
I just admire how much he's adapted. He taught me that life throws things out at you and can change in just a second, and you can't look back and be like, oh, wow. Like, you can't regret anything. You have to look at how you can make your life better, how you could keep going.
A lot of stuff happens in life. And, you know, there's nothing we can do to control the things that happen to us, you know, no matter what. But we can, you know, somehow figure out a way to just keep a smile on our face and, you know, make the best of it. Life isn't perfect, you know. So let's just have fun. It just happens to be that the way we have fun is riding motorcycles.
Doug rides on a bike that he designed for himself, and he controls the motorcycle entirely with his arms, shifting gears and using the brakes with his hands.
As a kid, riding with all my friends in the woods, all I ever wanted to be was Doug Henry. Doug was like pretty much my biggest inspiration hero.
I know Travis is still a little bit faster than me. Even though he's hurt, he's still faster than me, but you know, there's gonna be a day when it will get close again.
I don't exactly have the doctor's permission to be riding yet, but man, I tell you, if Doug Henry comes down to my house, I'm riding.
it's like I live on the bike. I love it. I don't know how to explain it. You just get lost. You know, I get away from everything. Every day you get a chance to ride, you know, you make the best of it.
When you ride a day with Travis Pastrana, you end up in the foam pit.
All right, so Travis, basically go ahead, hit it, go slow, and then just try and wheelie off of there.
You gotta wheelie off the top.
All right.
That's why it really shouldn't work. Like, physics say this is not gonna work.
I heard that all before, but just tell me it's just gotta...
There's very few people in this world that I would say, like, it can't be done, and that they'll still continue on, and that's why I've always looked up to Doug. Doug's like, nah, I got this.
Nice and slow, Doug. Yes! Yeah! That's why that man is my hero. That's not physically possible. Perfect. I can't do that.
I never even thought of doing this.
Yeah, but as soon as you finish the backflip, you said I'll do it.
I know. Now. Well, because it went so well.
You could do it. Yeah.
Nice! Woohoo! It's what I'm talking about! How cool is that, man? How wild is the front flip feel, huh?
That one's scary. Because you can't see nothing.
Nothing.
That was good, though.
It was really good.
That was really good.
Yeah, what, just confidence. No second guessing, no hesitation, no pre-run, just hit it.
That got me a good teacher.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
There's an ever-changing line between the insane and the sublime in this relationship between a man and his machine.
I mean, the bikes are just pieces of material, but there is something there that sometimes it feels like it has some life in it and can help you or even can send you home, so.
Riding that sharp edge between victory and disaster is exactly what shaped the MotoGP season. Following the Grand Prix in Austin, Danny Pedrosa would win both Spain and France, while defending champion Jorge Lorenzo came out on top in Catalonia. It was shaping up to be a three-man race for the championship. But then, during practice in the Netherlands, Lorenzo took a horrific fall. Badly breaking his collarbone, requiring a metal plate and 6 screws.
It's complicated to stay fit, not to get injured. It's hard when the hammer comes to you. Boom.
Pedrosa would also break his collarbone during the German Grand Prix.
There is kind of a memory in the body, you know, and sometimes when it's the pain is a lot, always the body tries to keep safe.
Meanwhile, Marquez would crash again and again. But somehow, every time, he bounced right back up and never get seriously hurt. With Pedrosa and Lorenzo nursing their injuries, the door was now wide open for Marquez.
The second Grand Prix victory bet. The checkered flag is out. Marquez wins here in Germany.
To the astonishment of the experts, the 20-year-old Spaniard had stormed to the top of the standings.
Didn't expect after 8 races lead the championship.
In his first race ever at Laguna Seca, Marquez was pushing harder than ever.
Arriving Marquez and Rossi in front of him. They're coming up towards the corkscrew. Is Marquez going to make a move at the corkscrew in his early stages?
And then Marquez goes for it on the inside of the corkscrew.
We all expected Marquez to be fast. We saw how fast he was in Moto2, but I don't think we expected him to be this fast so soon.
Winning at Laguna Seca, Indianapolis, and in the Czech Republic, Marquez made it four victories in a row.
Stunning stuff once more from the rookie.
But Lorenzo was healing and looking to win.
Marquez dives for the inside line. Marquez has got it and he's hanging on. Into Lorenzo. Is there any way left for Lorenzo, who has the inside?
Jorge Lorenzo surely is going to do this one. Jorge Lorenzo wins an incredible battle here at Silverstone.
Nevertheless, headed into the Australian Grand Prix, Marquez nearly had the championship wrapped up until he missed a mandatory pit stop.
Marquez has stayed out there. Marquez has stayed out on the track. I do not believe this, but surely Marquez has gone a lap too far.
This mistake would cause Marquez to be disqualified from the race.
It is Mark Marquez will not be getting any points if Lorenzo wins.
2013 World Championship has been blown wide, wide open.
With Marquez earning 0 points and Lorenzo winning, the MotoGP Championship was now up for grabs, and it would all come down to the wire, the final race at Valencia, Spain.
You want to think of the motorcycle as something that has an application, something it can bring to the world other than just that thrill and that excitement. You know, if you're driven by taking health care to a rural community rather than winning that race or that world championship, it's a very good tool.
MotoGP is not just about the race for the championship. It's about a community coming together for a very good cause. Like GP legend Randy Mamola heading up an auction to raise money for Riders for Health, a charitable organization started 25 years ago with the help of England's Princess Anne. Randy and his co-founders, Barry and Andrea Coleman, raised money to put motorcycles on the front lines of battling disease and malnutrition in the rural areas of Africa.
We're in 7 countries in Africa, with around 1,100 to 1,200 motorcycles working in those countries.
Given the sort of image of motorcycling and how it's been over the years, governments call us up and say, hey, motorcycle racing, we need your help here. Come and help us reach our unreached.
The Industrial Revolution really missed Africa. People were taking things out of Africa, not putting anything in. Machinery and all the things to do with that sort of development really were missed.
We have schools in which we teach them. We found a lot about Africans don't want it to be done. They want to do it themselves. You just got to give them the hands and the tools to do it.
The fact that there is still polio in the world, that is a transport question. That isn't because there isn't a vaccine. You've got absolutely appalling rates of women dying in childbirth only because nobody gets to them.
Most of the population of Zambia, maybe about 70%, is found in the rural. So it's imperative to take health services as close to the people as possible.
Before motorbike came in, we are not able to follow up them to the actual places where they are coming from, meaning that the disease was continuing. We've been able to reduce the cases. This time maybe we only have 2 to 3 cases per month. Before that, we used to have maybe 10 to 20 cases of malaria.
Choi jisima de tsovirwa. Yemo ibona kadi. Eh.
Actually, I'm actually now enjoying my work. Before the motorcycle came in, I was just thinking of leaving this place because it was quite challenging for me to be able to offer the services that I'm supposed to give to this community.
by maintaining our fleet at a zero breakdown basis, we can change the face of health delivery systems in Africa.
With his motorcycle, Derek is now able to see up to 300 patients per day. Not only is the motorcycle saving lives and changing the landscape of healthcare in Africa, Derek is becoming something of a two-wheel celebrity.
They have actually mastered the sound of my bike. We find that those who are still at their homes, when they hear the sounds, they leave whatever they are doing, then they learn to do the outreach post. To them, I'm a big star. Yeah.
Riding motorcycle to me is an experience that I can only explain when I'm riding the motorcycle, not when I'm sitting.
In Africa, the perception of motorcycles is just forming. But in other parts of the world, they sometimes are a source of conflict. In today's modern age of politics, environmental issues, and encroaching civilization, it's becoming harder and harder to find a place to ride, a place that you can call your own.
I opened up the newspaper and I saw our local motocross track was getting shut down. This place, Zaka Station, up the road from me. I love that place. It's been there for 7 years, and I ride there all the time. My friends ride there, and they brought their kids and taught them how to ride there.
If we didn't have Zaka, then I had to go like 2 hours away to go to Piru. Just a long drive.
You see your kids with a sense of accomplishment. Just going around the track once, for the first time without falling. The first little jump. I got air, Mom.
Makes me happy to see these guys leave here with a smile on their face. You know, that makes my day. You know, it's been pretty much my life. You know, this is what I love doing.
The threatened closure of Zaka due to noise pollution inspired Carlin to take a big gamble in his next race on a bike that would make no noise. A motorcycle that was completely electric.
They're battery electric vehicles, so it has to start with the battery. The batteries are getting better every year. You know, when we have a race like this, all the engineers come together, all the resources, all the support. You know, this is what it's about.
You know, I never really took any interest in it, because all I could think of is, yeah, it's got to be like the Prius of motorcycles. How awesome could that be? The outside world's not going to care about electric on electric. You know, you might have the fastest cockroach, but it's still the cockroach races. Whereas, you know, now we're going up against the big boys on the same playing field.
And if you want to find the big boys, Pike's Peak is it. It's the 50th year of one of the most legendary races in the U.S., the Pike's Peak Hill Climb, a 12.5-mile course with 156 turns, climbing from 6,000 to over 14,000 feet. The only thing more incredible than the scenery is the danger.
It's basically your self-preservation gene saying, slow down, slow down. You're gonna go off the cliff, you're gonna go to the trees, you're gonna go to the rocks. All the way to the top.
Carlin is a two-time Pike's Peak champion, winning once in 2011 as a privateer and again the following year on a factory Ducati, becoming the first motorcycle ever to beat the 10-minute mark. Now he was going for three in a row on an electric bike.
And I gotta say, at first, it was so different. You rely on these senses, like the sound and the vibration. And so instead of operating in this kind of chaotic, noisy environment, it just becomes calm. And I'm gonna just kind of doing this dance on the bike.
Electric bikes are basically silent. And in this case, they're actually too quiet. Because there are spectators lining the entire course, electric bikes are required to make some sort of noise. In Carlin's case, during testing, it was a car alarm.
So here I am, I'm trying to be zen, you know, I'm whatever. And my bike is like making the most hideous noise. But you can't turn it off or else they'll disqualify it. It's like, this is some sick joke.
Cruel irony is a recurring theme at Pikes Peak.
It's the challenge of the mountain and the forever changing weather conditions that can manipulate into storms and rain showers and snow showers in a matter of minutes.
For Carlin and Team Lightning, the rain was something of a concern.
I asked Richard if we could get some rain tires, and he looked at me funny why I'd ask him that, and he said that they'd never tested the bike in the rain before.
Yeah, nobody knows what happens when you take a 400-volt battery pack and you drench it with rain.
So maybe that might be a problem, too.
Yeah. You weren't looking to having kids down the line, were you?
As the sun rises, spectators arrive by the thousands, and competitors get their game faces on.
For every level of competitor that you see here, you have teams with manufacturer support going for victories in classes or overall. And then you have privateers coming that have tuned and tweaked on their own machinery and hand-built it themselves.
If you win, there's some money, but if I get up with my bike, with my personal bike, with a good lap time, I think I can cry for one entire day because, you know, it's a satisfaction.
Yeah, Marco's a great guy. 5 years, I think, is your fifth year.
Yeah, fifth year.
You know, if I can house the whole last couple of years, we'll house 5-6 Italians at our place. It's chaos for a week.
Is that right?
You're
going to stay in his house?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
It does build kind of a bond. You create these friends in kind of a somewhat of a stressful environment, but like I said before, you're doing something that you love and you feel so wholeheartedly about.
The rain held off, and the racers lined up. Carlin's starting time was 8:45 a.m. On my hands and knees, I'm coming home. I know when I've been beat. Can do is wait and watch at the bottom, but Carlin was in the lead after split two. Top of Pikes Peak, Carlin had set the day's fastest time on a motorcycle, beating all of his competitors by over 20 seconds. For the first time ever in a major event, an electric motorcycle had beaten all the competition. On this Sunday, Carlin Dunn had made history. Come Monday, he'd be back at his shop with his father selling motorcycles.
Here you go, Aid.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming out,
buddy.
Yeah, thanks.
In Spain, motorcycling is like a religion.
There's more motorcycles on a regular day in Barcelona than there is in Daytona Bike Week.
Because every kid in Spain wants to be a MotoGP racer.
Valencia, the last stop on the MotoGP Tour. And for the first time in 7 years, the championship would come down to the final race.
In Austin, in the second race of the season, I couldn't imagine that because, you know, it was my first season. I spoke with you that maybe here I would try to get my first victory, but then will be difficult. But yeah, we did a very good season, so now we are on the most important race.
As race day neared, the eyes of the entire nation were riveted on the track at Valencia.
You have all the fans together in one line, all the track. Motorcycle in Spain is something in the blood.
The championship had come down to two riders, defending champion Jorge Lorenzo and rookie Marc Márquez. Lorenzo needed the win. Márquez only needed to finish fourth and avoid making a big mistake. Lorenzo did everything he could to get inside Marc's head.
When you have the pressure, it's a little bit different, but in the end, try to make a normal race, not a special one.
Those on Marquez's team were worried that the young racer might take the bait and push too hard to beat Lorenzo, potentially crashing and costing him the championship.
The problem is that when you slow down, you lose a little bit the concentration. When you are pushing, when you are fast, you pay attention, you are more concentrated on the bike, on everything.
It's a beautiful afternoon here in Valencia to have the 18th and final round of MotoGP. 104,000 fans.
You really could not ask for any more. Marc Márquez has to finish fourth or above to clinch the world title. The current world champion, Jorge Lorenzo. 7 Grand Prix victories this season. Dani Pedrosa, the man that's got the best record here in Valencia. The whole of Spain is coming to a halt at this very moment, I can promise you. Lights to red, let battle commence.
A good start from Jorge Lorenzo yet again. He just comes up really nicely as the light went out. And look at that, Pedrosa is past Márquez. Márquez has come back and he's in third place as Lorenzo leads Pedrosa in second.
For Pedrosa, the race was not about winning. His goal was to protect his teammate and make sure that Lorenzo would leave Márquez alone.
Quite good that he's got Pedrosa just in front of him, harassing and harrying Lorenzo, because Lorenzo will know that he needs to win this race.
Pedrosa determined to help his teammate Márquez.
Lorenzo fighting back already into turn two. He forces Pedrosa wide and retakes the lead.
Yeah, he's doing a brilliant job, Dani Pedrosa. You were so right, because Lorenzo wants to start slowing the pace. He knows that Pedrosa is so capable of going by and absolutely clearing off.
What can Lorenzo respond with? Here he comes. He almost takes Dani Pedrosa's right leg off. Marc Márquez will be already wanting to shake Dani Pedrosa's hand because he's helping him out no end here.
And then come up towards the McDuitt curve. Lorenzo fights back. There's no way through that time. There he is. He's pushed Dani Pedrosa wide.
He's pushed him right off the track as well. He had to do it. And now Márquez sits over at the front. Can Márquez try and push away? This is perhaps what Lorenzo wanted. He's going to have to try and slow things up. He's got to play with the rookie.
Márquez doesn't need to be getting sucked into this, especially with Dani Pedrosa behind him.
Marc proved he could play Lorenzo's game, and with just 5 laps remaining, he let his loyal teammate Dani, the other hero of the day, ride on by to take second place.
MotoGP, becomes the first rookie since Kenny Roberts in 1978. The new world champion in MotoGP in 2013 is the rookie Marc Márquez. He's done it.
Marc Márquez had finally pulled it off. At age 20, the youngest MotoGP champion in history. For Márquez, On that one glorious Sunday afternoon, it felt like reality had taken a holiday. The truth about riding motorcycles is that there's way more to it than the cheering fans, the prize money, and the trophies. At the root of it all, it's simply about riding with your friends and having fun. And that's exactly what happens every Thanksgiving at Day in the Dirt in Glen Helen, California. Robbie Madison, Carlin Dunn, Roland Sands, Doug Henry, and hundreds of others show up to just go for a ride.
The fact that you have absolute heroes and legends on the same race course as a regular guy, and everybody treats everybody the same, and you don't even know that you're talking to Ricky John. Well, of course you would.
It doesn't matter if you're a seven-time national champion or this is your first time throwing a leg over a motorcycle. When you come out today in the dirt, it's more about family and friends.
We're all young together.
You and your machine are out there on the track trying to tackle these obstacles, and those times when you overcome a fear, when you hit that jump for the first time, that feeling, you can't get that feeling anywhere. I can't.
It's this big eclectic group. It's the end of the year. The season's over for everybody. So it's just kind of a who's who from every discipline.
This is what it's all about. I'm glad I'm finally old enough to be able to appreciate it, just have fun. I've been trying to win nothing.
The experiences it brings and the memories it can make and the friends you get from it, they're gonna last forever because you can always relate back to, oh, let's just go ride our dirt bikes for a day.
Never even get to use a roll cage.
It's a vehicle to see these places, to go explore. It means a lot more than going around with the camera and snapping photos off. On the back of a motorcycle, that's the way I want to see the world.
So for all you guys, let's do this lap for him and enjoy the day in the dirt. Thank you all for coming.
And I'm a kid I used to know. I'm flying over my shoulder through the dust. I'm calling, run forward and catch me if you can. On any Sunday.
Tasting the sun, the feeling in the earth,
dancing.